Fellas, we're in a hole full of coal gas here. The tiniest spark at the wrong time is going to be the end of it. So we've got to pick a way at this situation, slow and careful. We got to organize and build support. We got to work together. Together. Till they can't get their coal out of the ground without us, because we're a union. Because we're the workers, damn it, and we take care of each other. How can we shut the mines down if you're on dynamite? The men walk out. All of them.
Fat chance. And every man that walks out on his own steam, we take him to the union.
All the Dagos and all the colored?
That's what a union is, fellas. You better get used to it.
Your wife is with another man, and you don't care?
Nope. Our marriage is just for show. A commercial for how normal we are when we're anything but. Yes, man, you are shaking. We really ought to get you out of these clothes.
Yeah.
It's okay. You just tell me what you need. You got the wrong idea.
Ungracum sesquipedale. Beauty. God.
Darwin wrote about this one. Charles Darwin, evolution guy. Hello.
Yeah.
You see that nectary all the way down there? Darwin hypothesized a moth with a nose 12 inches long to pollinate it. And everyone thought he was a loon. And sure enough, they found this moth with a 12-inch proboscis. Proboscis means nose, by the way.
I know what proboscis means.
Hey, let's not get off the subject. This isn't a pissing contest. Point is, what's so wonderful is that every one of these flowers has a specific relationship with the insect that pollinates it.
Good afternoon, Marines.
Good afternoon, sir.
Jesus, did you just land in a war zone or a funeral parlor? Good afternoon, Marines.
Good afternoon, sir.
Ooh, I just felt my dick move. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Lieutenant Colonel Kaczynski, your battalion commander. We are now part of Operation Desert Shield. Just north of us, Saddam Hussein's got 1 million Iraqi soldiers. And some of those boys have been fighting since you were 9 or 10 years old. They are tough. They will stop at nothing. They've used nerve gas against the Iranians and the Kurds. Now here's a picture. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, let's kick ass and take names and end this shit the day before yesterday.
Yeah.
But the bureaucrats have a lot of jawboning to do. So for now, These Iraqis who have raped and pillaged poor little Kuwait are not yet in our gun sights. Our current mission is to protect the oil fields of our good friends in the Kingdom of Saud until further notice. And gentlemen, I'm talking a lot of oil. A lot of oil.
So I'm curious, when you say you don't eat meat, you mean you don't eat meat of any kind?
Right.
Is that for health reasons?
Well, when you eat meat, you ingest an animal's fear.
Ingest what? Its fur?
Fear.
How do you do that? You can't eat fear.
Sure you can. I mean, what happens to you when you feel afraid? Doesn't your body produce all sorts of chemical reactions?
Does it?
Well, it does.
Yes.
So when you eat meat, you're ingesting all of that fear that the animal felt when it was slaughtered to make food.
Right. You mean I've been eating fear, what, 3 times a day for 60
years? Right.
This one won't have a meal. It doesn't have meat in it.
Well, I guess it was just the way I was raised, but somehow it doesn't seem like a legitimate meal unless there's some meat somewhere.
Oh. What is it? What is it?
Dad?
Oh. What's the matter, Uncle Charlie?
Oh.
Dad, are you
big bite of fear. Fear never tasted so good.
People call me rich cause I got my money. I got more cheddar than some supersized nachos. Got cash flow like Robert has De Niro's. I use more greens than Vincent Van Gogh. I make the baker bake my bread out of dough. No, don't eat it though, it'll make you ill. There ain't no flour in a $100 bill.
He's tax rich man.
Oh yeah!
Everybody listen.
Here we go now.
Just how great it is to be here.
Oh, it's great to be me. Sing it again.
He's the greatest.
Ooh, it never gets old.
Puppets are a waste of time. Oh, can't you see?
Little Muppets, time to give up your dream.
Okay. So, let me introduce our moderator, who is Warren Etheredge. Many of you know he's been coming to the festival for many years. He was the awards night host for us for several years. He's one of the founding faculty of the Film School, which helps filmmakers translate their stories for screens big and small, and also the Red Badge Project, which helps combat veterans work through PTSD and other issues through the art of storytelling. He's conducted about 3,000 interviews, so welcome to 3001. On the page, on stage, and on screen. He hosts The High Bar, his Emmy-nominated TV series, and the founder of The Warren Report. He's the former curator for the One Reel Film Festival at Bumbershoot, and he is a programmer for the Seattle International Film Festival. And Warren has just begun a new film festival that's in Seattle called the Walla Walla Movie Crush Short Film Festival. Runs July 6th to 8th, 2018. He told me this morning he's already looked at 1,200 short films, and I think he told me that to make me feel like a slacker. I only looked at 250 or so for this festival. Chris Cooper is the recipient of this year's Rogue Award. We're giving him this award for his body of work as an actor, for his great taste in roles and his remarkable execution of those roles, and for his support of independent film and for helping indie films come into being. You saw from that first clip, and I'm sure you recognized his first featured role in John Sayles' Matewan, where he played the union activist. He also starred in a total of 5 of John Sayles' indie features, including Lone Star and Silver City. Last night, he brought us a powerful new independent documentary that he narrated and produced that's going to do a lot, I believe, to raise awareness of the injustices of intelligence testing and the segregation of people with disabilities. So please welcome to the podium Warren Etheredge and Chris Cooper.
it's great to sit next to a star. Can always pretend the ovation was for me. So good to see you here. I'm curious, I have heard you say that you don't take your characters home with you, but they're on your mind, and you keep some distance from your work. When you see a clip reel like that, how do you feel about that? Do you think, damn, that guy is good, or?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I see some work that over a stretch of, the take, I say, worked out pretty good, but you really, I think the actor is really aware time after time of seeing where he could have made an adjustment here or there, and things were just not quite on for that take that the director chose for one reason or another. And sometimes it's hard to look at. Yeah.
So were you doing that mental calculus right now, thinking you could have tweaked something? Your hip hop was flawless, but
no, those were some pretty good choices, I think. Yeah.
So I'm curious. Last night, Marianne reported in a Q&A that you once gave a young man the advice to get into acting because there are lots of ladies, and you'll be one of only the straight guys there. Was that your reason for joining, or you just wanted to get away from registered Hertzfords?
Yeah, it was obviously honestly one of the reasons. I mean, I started in theater at about age 16 when my friends were. I wanted to separate myself from my friends because the boys, they were getting into little petty crime here and there. And I knew I had an interest in theater, so I offered my time at a resident theater in the area and did everything but acting. So I hung lights, built sets, designed sets, painted, worked a light board, stage managed, was in the wings night after night as a scene shifter, watching these actors and what they did, and really getting a nice foundation, you know, for, and then I got serious about it at about second semester of my senior year at university. And the professors there, I felt were, I was very fortunate. I got a real good education because the professors found scripts that these students could really relate to, like View from the Bridge and, I did my junior and senior year, I did summer stock and learned how to dance, jazz ballet, tap dance, sing, all that stuff. So it was a good experience, good start.
I'm curious, do you think you always wanted to act and you just needed to overcome a hurdle? You've talked about overpowering shyness. Was that it, or you just didn't know?
Yeah, and you remind me of it was, I got irritated with my shyness. I knew it was killing me, and stepping into the theater, it was just wonderful, this mix of guys and girls, and it was a great way to kind of just rub elbows with them, and at university, it became a little family, It was very comfortable, very nice in a lot of ways.
I don't know a lot about your family, but it seems like that's some serious Midwestern working stock. What did your dad think of this career choice?
Dad thought it was the silliest thing a person could do.
Yeah.
And, he was a doctor, and he saw how engrossed I was in dramatic film. He said, "What do you want to get into?" I see drama at the hospital every day. And Mom had a real good artistic sense. She was a very fine artist and fashion designer, but not real encouraging. I have an older brother, And I think we're very different. My brother Chuck is about three years older than me. He's type A, really high strung, very, very funny guy. And Mom always thought, well, if anybody's going to be the actor, it's Chuck. As a matter of fact, she said, honey, you don't have too much of an imagination. Think long and hard. But that kind of spurred me on to say, yeah. Well, I'll show you.
And what does your brother do now?
He used to be fine home builder, and he moved down to Savannah, Georgia. And, you know, I mean, years ago, the bottom of the market fell out, and Savannah's kind of struggling. And he's hustling, you know, does government work and some renovation, restoration, still at it.
You, at some point, decided to move to New York to pursue theater, and you studied with some greats. You studied with Stella Adler and Wynn Hanman. I'd like to talk about them a little bit. Stella is famed for script analysis, and I know we're talking about craft today, and often Hollywood scripts today don't actually require script analysis, but for the actors out there, what does that mean? What did you learn? What do you do?
Well, jump ahead. In a nutshell, it's a great, for me, it's a great security blanket, you know. She, and I did take the script analysis class with her, and she was quite a character herself. But in a nutshell, she taught the class how to just dig deeper, keep asking questions about every line. You know, a writer writes, and as an example, with John Sayles. You don't mess with a John Sayles script. He can justify every word in that script. And there are some actors who have come aboard, been hired. I remember in City of Hope, great guy, Richard Dreyfuss. He said, well, I'm gonna, he came to work to shoot that scene that day. It was a long scene. And he started out and in his own way, he did his dial. John, cut. Well, okay, let's do it again. A couple of takes. Dreyfuss kept coming up with his own interpretation. They stepped aside, had a little talk, and you know, he was determined. You know, it's my words. So with each specific word, there's content behind it all, and I don't know how to explain it anymore, but she made you search deeply, you know. Time, place, and forget the script. If it's a certain period piece, what's happening economically? What's happening politically? What's happening religiously? You know, and when I say it's a security blanket, it's just having done your homework, you have something with you to, you know, put out there with little inside knowledge of what that character might be feeling, going through.
And some of that is work that you're doing a backstory for a character, right? Yeah. That you're building from the script analysis. But it's interesting because I believe I heard you talk about August Osage County, and talking about working with Margot, that you both had done backstory work, but it didn't really matter if you were on the same page exactly or not. It just mattered that you did the work.
More specifically, say like in American Beauty with Allison Janney, who played my wife, I approached her and I said, I want to create a timeline for us, for our relationship. Where did we meet? When did we meet? Was this marriage, was this first child by accident? I mean, we know, we realize the character, Colonel Fitz's background and what and who he is, and what he denied about himself. So we created this timeline, very basic, and then I go off and make specific what works for me, and Allison went off and worked within that timeline and found things that were specific for her. And there was no need for us to share that. That's kind of private business. It's the actor's private moment that nobody else needs to know about.
It's interesting to me because I've heard Rodrigo Garcia talk about this. He did something with Jason Isaac and Robin Wright in which they both did a lot of work together to get their backstories in sync, and they wanted to present it to him, and they did, and he said he didn't care. It's like, as long as you know, fine. Exactly. So what are you doing with that? What does that do for you as an actor? What are you doing with that backstory? What are you doing with that information?
It gives me my confidence. It gives me my character, you know? It gives me a history that I create, and it gives me my confidence.
I've heard you say that there are four things that you can count on for your work as an actor, that there's research, imagination, life experience, and then you're not so sure about talent, but we'll get to that later. So this is a part of the research process for you.
Yeah, research, and like you said, as a young man, fortunately, I had my taste of military, I had my taste of labor. I worked on the Kansas City Chiefs and Royals football and baseball stadium as a carpenter's helper for 1.5 years. That paid for 2 years of college back then. I roughed in some houses with my brother. I did a lot of farm work, ranch. My father and I raised registered Hereford cattle outside of Leavenworth, Kansas for about 20, 25 years. I almost took that on as a, to continue as, after my father. But I had the acting thing in mind, and I had to see it through, or I'm real sure I would have been real bitter.
I think we're all glad you did, that you chose acting over cattle. Thank you. Don't make us quite as much of a mark in cattle. but I'm curious... Doing all this research, it's a security blanket, but then you do a film like The Patriot, which was originally, I think the Smithsonian was behind it, and it was a true historical piece, and I presume you were doing that research to get
up
ready...
to a point.
To get to it. But then it shifted to a fictionalized piece, so do you then feel like the research was for naught, or you just, I'm just playing that guy,
I'm playing that guy. And the little nuance... The fun part I had with that, if we look at a lot of those period films, my question was, so many of these white guys were Brits. So where was the transition between the British dialect and they came to incorporate this American dialect? Where was my place? Where could I find something I was comfortable with? That was part of the homework. But now I kind of lost it. What?
That's okay. I think the transition was Al Pacino in Revolution doing his New York accent there.
Oh, man. Well, anyway, like you said, it was very exciting that the Smithsonian was going to be involved with this, and then the suits, back wherever they came from, wanted more and more violence, and we got farther and farther away from fact, and it always became kind of humorous for me to see that, you know, Mel Gibson's... His freed slaves loved him so much that they stayed on.
Well, Mel's just one of those guys.
And so it got to the point, it got so much more fictionalized that we had to change the character's name. I was supposed to play Light Horse Harry Lee, did great background research for him, and Mel's was the Swamp Fox, and so, you know, we had to change him.
There may have been a better movie if they'd stuck to the facts.
I think so.
Yeah. I want to go back to Win Hanman for a second. Something he's famous for talking about is that not only for training actors very well, but talking about how you are not always going to get a good script. You are not always going to get a knowledgeable director. And it's true.
You found some
good
stuff.
Thank
you. You found some great stuff. Yeah, I started class in New York with Wynn, having come from nothing but a theater background. I had done 15 years of theater before I ever did any film work. And it's one day in class, and in theater, I was kind of brought up that the director has the concept for this whole production. You put your faith in the director's hands. And one day, Wynn was talking to us, and he said, you know, there's going to become a time when the director doesn't know what he's doing. And you're going to have to save yourself. And I thought, what? And boy, it has come true. A handful of times, for real, yeah.
And I was going to ask you about that, and you don't have to name names or anything, but given how much you like to research, how much you like to be prepared, and if you get to set and you realize you're working with somebody who doesn't know what they're doing, what happens for you?
Boy, you just really have to forge ahead. You just have to protect yourself. And hope that in editing they can doctor it up or cut away. If you're involved with like a two-shot, right, these other actors, and you hope that they bring in the single. And there was one instance, a young actor who I never had this experience, but.
Is everybody trying to guess right now?
I can't tell the director's name because we'll all know what film it was. But the director came to me and said, I've been working with this kid. Just be aware, he'll look right through you. Mm-hmm. He's in his own world. Mm-hmm. And no connection, you know. And it was the strangest thing because he was just looking through me. And, the scene wasn't great, you know, it wasn't what it could have been, but you're certainly not going to tell the other actor, could you do this or that? You don't go there. That's the director's business.
But if the director's not protecting you, you just let it go and think, that's it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's as simple as that, man. Yeah. You gotta save yourself.
So you've been in a number of really good films and been cast with some wonderful people. How much of your career, how much has been brought about by working with those great people? How much do your co-stars determine the quality of your work?
How much do the co-stars determine?
The quality of your own work. You can't have somebody looking through you, right? But if you have somebody there, if you're working with Meryl Streep, I take it that's not bad.
Oh, it's not bad. and there's nobody like De Niro who can put you in the moment. I mean, there's a piece we did about the Hollywood blacklist in the 50s, and we have a confrontation in the big cafeteria of one of the studios, and he crosses from one corner of the cafeteria, and I'm seated and having my meal, and he picks me up and backs me up against the wall, and it's like, oh, man. Here's what we did, this rehearsal. You know, we did a little rehearsal the day before, and he's up against the wall with me, and we're doing our lines, kind of really whispering, oh, yeah, you think that? Well, fuck you. This is what I think, so on and so forth. Okay, we know how to do it. When De Niro came in that first take, it's like, you better jump in because he's going to roll right over you. He is not going to stop. You know, he carries that dialogue right on through. It's not you say your line, I'll say my line.
Right.
He woke me up on that first take. I said, oh, okay, so that's how it's going to be. And it was a great lesson. It was a great lesson.
To
and working and working with Merrill in August Osage County, nobody can appreciate her talent unless you're on set. Because after each take, she would say, "Okay, I'm satisfied." In her, and she was saying, "I gave this take where I'm heavily, heavily drugged. Okay. I was happy with that. Okay, now I'm going to do the take where I'm feeling giddy." And, you know, she changed it up so much, and that's such a treasure, that's such a precious gift to the director and to the editors to choose, have so much to choose from. And sometimes it's very hard, you know, there's one's as good as the other. But to change it up like that, I learned that in adaptation, in the audition process. Right. And, you know, if anybody's, if you're not familiar with the process, generally you, with the director, the little video mock camera is rolling and you do your audition. You do your version of the audition. And then if the director likes it, he may want to make a little adjustment and say, let's do it again, but this time try this. Well, for John LaRoche, I just saw too many ways to play the guy, just so many ways, and I begged Spike. I said, please, I can't give you my definitive idea of this character. Let me do a couple of scenes and show you different ways to play this. And so we did four scenes, three or four different ways. And the whole audition probably lasted about 45 minutes. And that was the case with Merrill. I mean, I just saw variety, you know.
For adaptation, you actually took that to the shoot, too, because you continued to do that during the production.
Exactly. Yeah, Spike really liked it, and he pulled that on me each day with, try it this way. When you pick up Merrill for the first time, you've got this stinking truck with dead flowers and dead, you know, in the back of your truck, and you're picking her up in this filthy truck. You're a little intimidated. Here's this New York journalist, very, you know, smart woman, and so let's try it that way. And then, okay, second time around, this smart-ass Easterner, she thinks she's going to, she's lucky to spend time with you. You're a very smart guy. You know that. Let's try it that way. We just continued that. And so, at the end result, when we go see the premiere, it's a surprise to me to see what takes Spike chose, you know. It became very exciting.
Did you just trust in that process and trust in Spike the whole time and thinking that he's going to pick the best Chris Cooper performance possible?
Well, I certainly did trust him, yeah. Kind of heartbreaking, all the scenes that got cut. Oh, my God. We did some beautiful scenes with Merrill, and it was the one film where we got to do a little improvisation. And we decided, let's start the scene with improvisation, work our way into the dialogue, and work our way out. And we did that for a handful of scenes, and... gosh, I wish we had some of that footage. You know.
Maybe out there somewhere.
Yeah.
Somebody has it. I'd like to go back to your first film, Mate One, 87, I believe, which was a big year for you. Mm-hmm. You've talked about, obviously, John Sayles, wonderful, and we can talk about him a little bit, but you've talked about having been excited to work with Haskell Wexler. And I was wondering why that was so enticing to you. You seem to be really drawn to the crew as well as the directors.
Well, I don't know what year it came out, and you'll probably, some of you may know better. I saw Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, and I don't know what age I was, but I know I went with my parents to the drive-in to watch that film.
That's a great family night out.
And I saw. I'll tell you something. And that was that black and white, and Haskell shot that film. That film knocked me out, you know. And to be in, work with Haskell and dare to, God bless him, he was so wonderful. You know, I needed to learn how to work with a camera, so Haskell and I would go back and forth. They said, you know, where's a good angle for me? What works for you? Do I need to help you in your camera work? Tell me what I can do and how I can look good. This is my first time around, you know, with film work. So he was gracious enough to, you know, talk about, maybe little stories about Henry Fonda, and I'm just totally captivated, you know. But he was very gracious and very helpful.
Should actors have that level of awareness of how it's being shot, or should they just be focused on their work?
I don't know if there are any shoulds, you know. I'm sure there are some who don't give a damn about where they're looking, and they give off pretty good performances. It's all hit and miss. Really, it's all hit and miss every time.
your batting average is pretty good, so it's okay. You've also talked about costuming, and you have people like De Niro talk about it starts with the shoes. For you, what does costume bring, and how much do you get involved with that?
I sit down with the, and I think they really, really appreciate it. I sit down with the costumers. And for this last film I did, Live by Night, she had just spent a year and a half before doing The Revenant, and I knew she was a serious person to deal with, and she came up with the most a costume for my character that I never would have dreamed of, but it was so right, you know. And I can sometimes think of a costume I'd like to wear, and I can be really off, you know. I can think of in terms of what feels comfortable for me, and
right.
That's not necessarily the right choice.
Right, a character doesn't have to be comfortable in his own skin, as it were.
Yeah.
Right. I'd like to open it up for some questions. I have 100 more, but I want to open up. Yes.
I just want to thank you for your bravery and the chilling performance in American Beauty.
Thank you. Thank you.
Please. But what I really want to comment on is adaptation, and your, again, great performance and your ability to expose yourself, because I too have front tooth loss, and I came out of the dental closet because of you. But it was very brave, I think, to expose yourself like that.
But do you know that film, women found me the most sexy?
I'm taking them out.
Hold on.
Thank goodness. You know, they set it up so that I could go local. We live around Plymouth Bay, around near Plymouth Bay. So there was. They sent me to a dentist's office to get the form of my teeth, so they could send that to the studio in L.A. and they could develop a plate with the missing teeth that I would put over my teeth. And thank goodness they sent several sets back home, because I had to live with those. And I lived with them for about a month and a half before we shot. So it was a little weird walking around the house with them.
Really?
Yeah.
Who knew toothless was going to catch on as a look? But trendsetter. Yes.
I wanted to piggyback off of what he said about American Beauty. As the daughter of a gay man who was closeted, married my mother, had me in the 60s to, for whatever reason, you know, keep himself in the closet. And he passed away a few years before the film came out. And when I saw it, your nuanced performance as someone who was so self-loathing and struggled so much with everything that he was going through, just, it gutted me. And as a, you know, I just wanted to thank you so much for that.
Thank you very much. Thanks. I'd like to say you nailed it. When I was trying to get into the skin of this character, and I was talking to my wife, Marianne, about the character, and thank goodness, there's an astrologer, however you feel about astrology, this woman, Jungian psychologist who studies astrology, Liz Green, and there was a chapter in one of her talks where she talked about the shadow side, things that you find in people that you don't like that are a mirror image of you, and it became so clear in a nutshell. It was the self-loathing of this character that was an important part of developing him.
So I want to follow up on that, if I may. It's interesting because I heard you talk about playing a character in Money Train that you didn't like because you didn't want to go to those dark places. If you're playing a character like the one in American Beauty, is that something that you take with you and hold with you?
Yeah. Marianne, you know, thank goodness. The rewrites for American Beauty kept coming. And the story got darker and darker and darker and darker. And I said, man, do I want to go there? And thank God, Marianne said, you're starting to get afraid of this character. And when that happens, you better do it, you know. And she was so right.
Because I've heard you say that too. Like, if there's a character that you're shying away from, it means you should run towards it. I think that actually comes from Marianne. Mm-hmm. But can you explain that? She's good.
but you know, it's not all the time. It's sometimes, yeah, I should, you know, not take this role. But I don't know. I don't know how to explain it any more than taking the leap. I mean, that's what we're supposed to do as actors. And there are moments where it just some of these scripts got the better of me, and the work that I knew it would entail frightened me. You know, it's as simple as that.
I'm getting the feeling that you would do a lot less work if you were not married.
That's a given. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being here. That scene in American Beauty, for me, was one of the best reveals of all movies that I've ever seen. And as an actress, also rooted in theater, your performance and allowing that subtext to come through, what you didn't say, just showing it, was so potent. Can you speak to that, what it takes to allow the stuff between the lines to come out, and how much of that was you and how much of it was your director helping you do that?
So that scene, from the time I entered the garage to the time I left, we covered that from sunset to sunrise over a two-night period. And I don't know how many times we shot the scene per night, probably 12, maybe 15 takes. So interesting things came about, you know, in the kiss. It was like Kevin has stubble, and it was like, oh my God, I'm all night I've been kissing this man, and I realize why sometimes women may not appreciate it. thank goodness for the camera work. I think there were several takes where they did the over the shoulder of Kevin when I put my hand on his shoulder blade. They missed it the first time or two, and then somebody caught it, and they thought that was a nice touch. So we kept it that, but just, you know, take after take, you try to build and make it a little better each time, or add something to it. And it's a long time ago, but some of those things stand out, some of those memories.
Over there, yes, back here. Yeah.
Hi, thank you. Would you talk about maybe one of the best things that a director did to work with you in a performance, and maybe also one of the worst things? This would be sort of like your advice to directors kind of question.
Honestly, because I felt so fortunate that John Sayles gave me my first job, and we've done 5 films together and hope to do one again this summer. So we've averaged, over the 25, 30-year period, we've averaged a film every 5 years together. But John set such a standard for me of what a production company, cast, crew, where everybody's head should be, you know. He always balanced his crew with, I mean, this is back in 84, 85, 86, whenever we shot it. He balanced his crew with men and women. You also got the opportunity to go up a rung in the ladder as a crew member, whether you're a gaffer or in lighting. He offered people a chance to step up a level. He taught me that time was money. Come prepared with several choices. One thing that John did that I don't know any other director has ever done is he will send every actor a single-spaced page or two of background. Now, hopefully, the actor is going to do his own background, but he gives you a fantastic starting point, you know.
That was for Richard Dreyfuss.
So I hope I answered your question. Mm.
But she also asked about the worst thing a director has ever done.
Worst thing, the worst thing is to give direction that I just totally disagree with. I did a period piece, and the director wanted me to deal with the other cast member just too gently. And the situation was that this cast member was going to leave a dangerous mountain, during the gold rush, a mountain town, and she was going to find her way back to San Francisco by herself. And I'm working with this actress, and yeah, my character was a little hard. I'm saying you can't go out there. You will die. You will be eaten by bears. You'll be, you know, you can't handle the countryside. And the director wanted me to be much more gentle, you know, and with a sensitivity that just wasn't practical.
So I guess the key is, do you argue that, or do you just accept it?
You know, I don't throw my weight around. I don't, you know, I try not to throw my weight around. But we went back and forth, and I said, you know, this is, I'm not reading you, you know. And she allowed me, and it worked well. She let me play my interpretation.
Yeah, definitely. Incidentally, I haven't figured out the young actor, but I think I know that movie. So keep playing the game. Any questions over here? My blind side. No?
Okay.
Yes. Hold. Wait, please wait. Please hold. We've got somebody coming with a...
I just wanted to say that I grew up in the Appalachians, and we decided...
Right.
My husband and I decided to go to see Matewan because it was related to an area that I knew something about.
Yeah.
And the movie became my husband's favorite film of his life.
Well, I must.
And we watched it over and over as he was aging and ultimately dying. And I wanted you to know that.
Thank you. We really did as a company, working in those hollers. We really had to gain the respect of the people that lived there because they had been so poorly represented in previous series shows and once again, John was the perfect person to handle that situation, and we got on and they accepted us just completely, and I think that was through John and Maggie, his mate, Maggie Brinsey, who never gets enough praise for her part, the part that she plays. But we were very welcome, and I think many people respected and loved that film.
You know. The respect you showed was very evident through the process.
Nice. You've clearly seen it a lot, but for those who haven't seen Matewan or haven't watched in a long time, go back because you get a sense of it in that clip. Not just Chris, but the rest of that cast is fantastic. It's a great movie, but that cast is stellar across the board. It's really an amazing film to watch. It holds up beautifully. Sorry.
Hi, you talked about working with directors that you feel don't know what they're doing, but how do you differentiate between working with perhaps a talented but inexperienced director when you're making your choices to work on a project or not?
Do you have a project? Is that where I'm? Okay. That's
I still do that. There have been some low budget or independent films pretty recently where the director's been first-time director. And I just go back to say, I try to come prepared. You know, I try to come with strong, strong choices. And I think maybe a little-known fact is directors have so much to deal with every day. They have so many choices to make. I want to make things easy for the director. I don't want to, before the scene, have a 30-minute talk about, well, how should I feel? You get the sense of the scene. You just come prepared, do the work, and make it easy on the director. And once again, if they don't know what they're doing, you just got to forge ahead.
I'm curious, though, do you ever do any work in advance? If it's on a small project, not in terms of your acting, but do you ever sort of interview the filmmaker if it's a first-timer? Do you interview her or him to see if they know what they're...
I will always, I am DB Google the person, find out what they've done or haven't done, who else is aboard, who's the DP, and look at what they've done before. I think that's part of the just protecting yourself.
Sounds fair.
Time for maybe two more.
Okay. Yes.
My question has to do with the intersection of being an actor and a social activist. I was really struck last night at the premiere of Intelligent Lives about the kind of the dynamic between you and Marion in talking about the film. And I just wondered, what is that process like for you, if there is one, in terms of where those different roles meet?
Oh, gosh. I guess for those that didn't see the film, are there a number of folks that didn't see the film last night? Well, it's a study of three young adults who are trying to find their way in the world with intellectual disabilities, and with the help of people around them, they're finding their comfort zone, their living zone, in their communities. And Marianne and I had a son with severe disabilities. And we lost him in 2005 at age 17, but continued to work locally with families and kids with disabilities. And to answer your questions, sometimes I can deal with it, sometimes I can't. And it just depends on I don't know. Sometimes Marianne's just got to take over, and I don't know how she does it, but I know how she deals with it. She writes. She wrote a great, wonderful book about our son. In order to be closer to him, you know. But it's it just depends. You know, it just depends on the moment.
Mm-hmm. Marianne's also a confessed rageaholic, so you get that out in words and anger. Okay.
I was just wondering about your experience on The Horse Whisperer.
The Horse Whisperer.
One of my all-time favorite films.
Oh, thanks. Right. Thanks. Well, that's where living the real life of a cowboy, ranching with my father, doing all those duties, roundup, tattooing, vaccinating, castrating, weaning, taking them to market, living that life, not sleeping in a bed for a while, that really serves you well when you get into those pieces. You know, I mean, you have real life experience to bring to those characters. And that's that. Yeah.
Before we wrap, I want to echo something. I loved your comments about Intelligent Lives, and I know it's hard for you to talk about Jesse, but watching you and Marianne on stage last night was incredibly touching because you could see the emotion and the passion there. But also, it struck me in reading your book, Marianne, and getting to meet you, that you and Jesse have a lot in common in a certain way. Sort of possibly quiet externally, not a lot of words necessarily, but a lot of love, which was in Jesse's poetry and just his life, and that you share in your acting. Mm. And I think it's a beautiful bond between the two of you. And you talk about how Jesse changed so many lives around him. And I hope you realize that not only with the movie last night, but with your work, you are changing lives daily. So thank you for speaking.
I just say the last thing, that this business that I'm in can be very selfish, and we all know that. You're often treated like kings on a production. But the one thing that Jesse taught us, he really taught us the important things in life.
Thank you. So I just want to let you know that for those of you who want to continue the conversation about intelligent lives, there's a community conversation this afternoon at 5:15 p.m. There'll be more opportunity to hear from Marianne and also talk with her about the book that she wrote. And again, this will be at 5:15 at the Elks Lodge, right across the street, 2nd Street. Please join us. And for the future talkbacks, thank you so much, Chris Cooper, for coming here, and Warren for moderating.
Thank you, sir. You made a world. Thank you.